Nikhil Srivastava from Microsoft Research India, and he'll be a local here very soon. We all know Nikhil for his fantastic recent work on the Kadison-Singer conjecture and the construction of Ramanujan's expanders. Today he'll tell us about what started all this line of work on graph sparsification, and then let people speak.
Okay, so thanks a lot, Prasad. Thanks for the introduction. And thanks for the invitation also, actually. So this is going to be a three-part thing about graph sparsification, and you know, it's going to go pretty slow. So if you don't understand anything, please stop me, and you know, we'll figure it out. Okay. So I'm going to talk about graph sparsification. So this is the basic objects are undirected finite graphs. So this is a weighted graph sheet, turned on negative. And the question that I'm interested in is this question. So given this graph G, which is an arbitrary weighted graph, I want to find the sparse graph H, which is close to G in some sort of rigorous well-defined sense. So I want H to be an approximation of G. And H and G are going to have the same set of vertices, but they're going to have different edges. So in particular, I want H to have very few edges. So I want H to have maybe average constant degree or polylogarithmic constant degree. So I want it to be sparse. And I'm going to allow the weights in H to be different from the weights in G. So these are these varying thicknesses of the orange lines here. And nonetheless, I want H to be close to G in some sort of rigorous. And there are essentially two reasons why I want to do this. So the first is that you can view this as some form of compression where, you know, G, if it has n vertices, might have up to n squared edges. It might take a lot of storage to store. And if I can find an H with, you know, order n edges or something like that, then I've really saved a lot of storage. And if H is close to G, then, you know, I've saved myself some storage. The other reason is that if I can prove that something like this is true for arbitrary graphs G, then it's just an interesting graph theoretic statement that every graph is close to a sparse graph. You know, so as I said, you know, this is a sort of sample application. You have some graph on, say some dense graph which takes a lot of storage and, you know, takes a lot of computation. And maybe you can, sparsify it down to a much smaller graph which sort of has the same shape in some sort of well-defined sense. And this is going to be lossy. It's not going to be exact compression. And then maybe I can run some computation on this, which might be a lot faster than the graph. So I stole this picture from Nick Harvey. Okay. So of course, whether or not you can do this depends on what you mean by approximation. Right, so you know, if I'm interested in knowing, you know, whether or not every single edge in the graph is present, then of course I can't compress it because deleting one edge is gonna, you know, destroy that. But suppose I'm interested in some sort of coarser property of the graph. Right, so you know, if you're in computer science, you're interested in sizes of cuts in the graph, which is, you know, things like finding bottlenecks in a road network or something like that. You might be interested in finding clusters in the graph, so like finding communities on Facebook. You might be interested in distances, computing shortest paths. You might be interested in random walks on the graph, so how quickly does a random walk get lost, or questions like that. Or flows, you know, simulating other physical processes. Or some classical graph theory parameters like coloring, you know, is a graph bipartite? Does it have a Hamiltonian cycle? You might be interested in counting the number of triangles. So these are all different properties of graphs that people are interested in for various reasons, and they're all, you know, coarser than storing every edge in the graph. So what I'm going to show you today is a notion of approximation which preserves, you know, some of these properties, preserves these ones. Basically the sizes of cuts, communities, something about the behavior of random walks, and in particular it preserves the behavior of electrical flows and other physical processes on the graph. So before I get to this, let me show you, you know, a simpler notion of sparsification, which sort of, you know, started this whole line of work, that just focuses on the sizes of cuts. So this is the notion of cut approximation, due to Bexler and Carter from 1996. So they're just interested in cuts. And the definition that they give is that a graph H approximates a graph G if for every subset S of the nodes, so H and G have the same vertex set, so if for every subset in G, there's a corresponding subset in H. If for every subset of the nodes, the total weight of the edges leaving the set is approximately equal in H and in G, up to a multiplicative factor. All right. So what I'd like to happen is sort of show in this picture, you know, here's on the left you have G, there's some cut S in G, and it has a bunch of edges crossing it. I'm going to look at the same cut in H, and you know, I don't necessarily want all the edges to be there, I just want the total weight to be the same. And since H is sparse, it's going to have fewer edges, and in order to achieve this, I'm going to have to blow up the weights of edges in H. All right. So the pictures, there might only be two edges, but their weights should be appropriately rescaled, so these numbers are close up to some multiplicative function. So multiplicative is very important. So this has a very different nature from if I ask for additive approximation of cuts. And roughly the reason multiplicative is interesting is that often we're interested in very small cuts in the graph. And multiplicative is a better notion if you care about small cuts. All right. So is the definition clear? Are there any questions about this definition? So here's an example of a case where cut sparse part actually exists. So it's a complete graph. So the input graph G is just a complete graph that it knows. It has, you know, edges to edges. And it turns out that I can get a very good approximation to this graph if I take a random D-regular graph. So what I mean by that specifically is I take D random matchings, where D is a small number like 3 or 5, or it's a constant, it's not growing with N. And I take this to be my graph, H. So this has you know, degree D, so it has order N edges if D is a constant, so it's actually very sparse. Now, if I look at any cut in G, then the number of edges leaving the cut is just the product of the sizes of the two sides of the cut, the low edges of the present, right? And if I look at the corresponding cut in H, then H is a random graph, so you know, I don't know exactly how many edges there are going to be, but I can compute the expected number of cuts leaving some set S. And an expectation, it's about what I expect times the scaling factor d over n, because the density of edges here is d over n times what it is here. So the expected number of edges in every cut is d over n times whatever it was in the complete graph. And actually, it turns out that you can show that, you know, for appropriate parameters d, with high probability, this is true for all cuts, actually. It's not just true for a particular cut. For every cut, the number of edges crossing is close to its expectation. And in particular, what that implies, if you look at any cut, then the ratio of the weight in G to the weight in H is about n over D. Okay? So this is some of what I said earlier. I said I wanted it to be 1 plus or minus epsilon. But it turns out this is always within a constant factor of n over D. So what I can do is I can take my graph H and blow up the weights all by n over D. And then this ratio becomes close to 1. And this makes a lot of sense because, you know, the total mass of the edges has to be preserved. Okay, so that's how you approximate a complete graph. This is called an expander graph, and you all probably already heard about this, and you'll probably hear a lot more about it in this boot camp. Here's this sort of amazing theorem, really bold theorem that Benzor and Cargo proved. They showed that for every graph G, you can quickly find a graph H with n log n over epsilon squared edges, so that all cuts are preserved up to this factor, 1 plus or minus epsilon. And for arbitrary weighted graphs. And what this means is if you're interested in cut problems like min-cut or sparsest cut, then you can always do this first. And by quickly, they showed how to do this very quickly, nearly linear time and the size of the input. So essentially, you know, as long as it takes to even look at the graph, you can sparsify it to this thing that preserves all the cuts. And then this was used in a lot of cut optimization problems. And well, now it's still used a lot in cut problems. And I want to say that this bound n log n is actually really good, because you definitely can't go below order n, right? If you take less than n minus 1 edges, you're going to disconnect the graph. So you certainly need at least a spanning tree. So this is within a log factor of optimal. Good. So what I'm going to describe today is a different notion of approximation introduced by Spielman and Teng, which is called spectral approximation, but I'm going to call it physical approximation, because that's how I like to think about it. Let me describe what this is. So it arises from viewing a graph as a physical object. So, you know, think of a graph as a combinatorial object with vertices and nodes. I'm going to associate this with a physical object, which is a resistor network. So let's say I have an unweighted graph that looks like this. So for every edge, I'm going to identify it with a 1-ohm resistor. So it's a wire of resistance 1, and then there are these nodes. And what I'm going to be interested in is you know, the behavior of this in an electrical circuit. So I'm going to look at electrical potentials on these nodes. So if the vertex head is V, the potential is just some real value function x on the node. So just a vector in Rn if there are n nodes. And so for example, you know, I could take this graph and I could put these potentials on the nodes. And then I'm interested, the quantity I'm going to be interested in is the energy dissipation. So the energy dissipation is the sum of potential differences squared. This is this formula that you learned in high school for, you know, heat dissipation in an electrical network. So for example, for these potentials, you know, all I do is I look at all the wires and I just add up the squared differences in the potential that I get the number. And this is the energy. So this is the definition of approximation we're going to be interested in. H is a kappa approximation of G, where kappa is some approximation factor. If for every setting of potentials X on the vertices, this energy function is approximately the same for H and for G, up to this factor kappa, which I want to think of being, you know, usually a constant. So you want to think of this as saying that these two graphs are somehow equivalent as electrical networks. So, you know, any electrical flow problem in one will have roughly the same energy in the other. And, you know, as I said, this energy is just the sum of squared potential differences across the edges. If the graph is weighted, then these terms are just weighted by whatever the weights are. So given a graph with weights W, I want this, you know, sum of squares with weights W to be approximated by the sum of squares with weights U, which are the weights in my approximation H. And I want this to hold for every H. So this thing is a quadratic polynomial. It's a homogeneous quadratic polynomial. Turns out it's a quadratic form in a matrix called the Laplacian matrix, which you already saw. So you can write this as X transpose LX, where L is a Laplacian matrix. So this notion of approximation just asks that these Laplacian quadratic forms are pointwise approximated up to this factor kappa, multiplicatively. And just to, you know, recall, the Laplacian matrix is written as a sum of outer products over the edges. So I'm sorry, this ij should be over the edges of G. So it's the weight of the edge times this vector delta I minus delta j times delta I minus delta j transpose. So, I mean, I don't know. I used to be not comfortable with outer products. So if you're not, I mean, this vector is literally, so all my vectors are Galois vectors. This vector is just a vector with a plus one in position I and minus one in position j. And so it's an n by one vector. I'm going to multiply it by its transpose. And I'm going to get an n by a matrix. So that's what each of these terms looks like. That's a Laplacian of a single edge. That's a Laplacian matrix of a single edge. And the Laplacian matrix of the whole thing is just the sum of all these guys over all the edges. Yeah, this is what I just said. Okay, so let's, you know, pause to review some of the properties of this matrix. So, you know, as I said, it's a sum of outer products, a weighted sum of outer products. The outer products are just Laplacians of single edges. The quadratic form, this X transpose LX, is always non-negative because it's a sum of squares. So that means that this matrix is positive semi-definite, which also means that all of its eigenvalues are non-negative. And I'm going to denote this by saying LG is bigger than 0 with this squiggly period of greater than or equal to 0. So A greater than B in this ordering means the quadratic form of A is bigger than the quadratic form of B for all X. I also know what the null space of this matrix is. Okay? So I know exactly what the multiplicity of the zero eigenvalue is if the graph is connected. So again, you know, the way to see this is, so the statement is that if the graph is connected, the null space is the span of the all ones vector. So it's easy to see that the all ones vector is in the null space, because if I plug all ones here, I just get zero. But in fact, because this is a sum of squares, this is zero if and only if each of these terms, xi minus xj, is zero. Which means it's zero for every edge of the graph. So if the graph is connected, it means that the function x has to be constant on the whole graph. So the null space is just equal to the span of the one vector. So I know exactly what it is. And what this means is I can sort of talk about inverses. Okay? So the matrix is singular, but all the vectors I'm going to be looking at in this talk are actually orthogonal to the null space, they're orthogonal to the all one vector. So I'm going to talk about the inverse, LG inverse, which is also a positive semidefinite matrix. And the reason it's positive semidefinite is because its eigenvalues are just the reciprocals of the eigenvalues of LG, which are positive, not negative. So I'm going to talk about the inverse. And I'm also going to talk about the square root of the inverse. So if I have a positive semidefinite matrix so eigenvalues are not negative, I can take their square roots and get some real numbers. That gives me another matrix that's a square root. So I'm going to talk about the square root of the inverse quite a bit. Now, is anybody bothered by this? If you want, I can you know, diagonalize a matrix and show you that this is okay. Is this okay? All right. So you know, with this notation, the physical approximation just says that L of H is L of H is sandwiched between kappa, L of D, and L of G. Okay, so why would you want to do this? So the first reason is that it recovers what we already know from Benkler-Karger. So it turns out that if you preserve the energy, this energy function of a graph, you also preserve all this cut. So basically, you can encode an arbitrary cut in a graph in this quadratic form as follows. So suppose you have a cut S. You can look at the indicator vector of the cut. That's a 0, 1 value vector. If you compute the energy of this vector, the only non-zero terms correspond to edges that have an endpoint inside the cut and one endpoint outside the cut. So you just get a sum of squared, well, ones for all the edges that are crossing the cut. And if it's a weighted graph, you get the total weight of edges crossing the cut. So 0, 1 valued potentials encode this combinatorial information, which is the cuts in the graph. So in particular, this physical approximation implies the cut approximation. So if I can preserve this quadratic form, I get all the cuts for free. And it's actually a strictly stronger notion. So it's not just, it's a strict generalization. So it turns out that the converse is not true, that preserving cuts does not preserve this quadratic form. And here's a canonical example. The graph is just a cycle. And notice that its min cut is equal to 2. So in particular, if I delete one of the edges, so if I take this graph G and delete one of the edges, I get a path. That's my graph H. That's a 2 approximation just because I only deleted one edge. So I reduce the size of any cut by at most 1, so at most half. So it's a cut approximation. But it turns out it's not a spectral approximation. So it does not approximate the energy. And the reason is if I assign potentials like this, 1 through n, starting at the endpoints of this edge that I deleted, then if I look at the left-hand side, the total, the value of this quadratic form, it gets a contribution of 1 for each one of the edges other than the red edge, and a contribution of n minus 1 for the red edge. So it's order n squared. But if I do it for the path, I just get n minus 1. So even though it's a 2-factor cut approximation, it's off by a factor of n for this quadratic form. So this really is a stronger note. Sorry. So it's better than the cut approximation. What can I do with it that I can't do with the cut approximation? So it turns out that this quadratic form, this energy, controls a bunch of physical processes on the graph. So I already told you, if you view the graph as a resistor network, then this is the natural notion of energy there, and in particular, it governs the behavior of this electrical flows on the graph. So electrical flow is when you take such a graph and you put a current source across two of its vertices or across a larger set of its vertices, and so you inject and remove current, and then the current flows through the graph. The shape of this flow is the shape of the flow is determined by the energy. In particular, it's the flow that minimizes the energy. You can also view this graph as a spring network, which is the same thing. If you put springs on the edges and you nail down some of the nodes and you wanted to see where this thing settles, again, this does some sort of energy minimization which depends on this quadratic form. And less obvious is if you looked at heat propagation on the graph. This is also determined by the Laplacian quadratic form. And it turns basically solving any of these problems, simulating them, amounts to solving a linear system of linear equations with the Laplacian matrix. And so, John is going to give a bunch of talks about this, and hear a lot about this week. So anyway, these are all pretty well-motivated problems, and so it's, one wants to be able to solve such linear equations quickly, and this is what motivated Spielman and Tang originally when they came up with this. So it turns out that if you have G and H, so that their quadratic forms are close, then you can reduce solving linear equations in L of G to solving linear equations in L of H using something called preconditioned constant gradient. But I won't go into that, but there's this reduction. So if you can compute these approximations, You can reduce, so these approximations are useful for solving linear equation. And this turns out, I mean, this is an important component in giving some really fast algorithms to this. So, you know, a priori, for a graph on n nodes, this might take n cubed time to solve by Gaussian elimination. Or if you use fast matrix multiplication, it's n to some exponent that's much closer to 2. But still, if the graph is, say, sparse, this is much bigger than the size of the input. And what Spielman and Tang showed in 2004 is that you can actually solve these systems at time m polylog n for some large polylog. And this crucially relied on the existence of these physical approximations. For every graph, you can find an h with n polylog n edges quickly. And then there's been a lot of follow-up work after this. Now, actually, the running time is down to m square root log n, which is faster than sorting. So it's pretty insane. But anyway, the original construction needed this notion of approximation. And then once you can solve this, you can simulate all these physical processes. And then there's this, in the last 10 years, well, even years before, there have been a lot of algorithms for classic, you know, computer science problems, like max flow or generating random spanning trees, graph partitioning, and so on, which actually operate by simulating these physical processes quickly. So not only can you do scientific computing, you can also solve, I mean, now some of the fastest algorithms for these, you know, discrete problems are based on solving these linear equations, which, Oleg is going to talk about that. Okay. Another reason is, spectral graph theory. So the quadratic form of matrix determines all of its eigenvalues. So, you know, the largest eigenvalue is the maximizer, the least is the minimizer, and you can get the k as one as well. So if H is this physical approximation of G, if the quadratic forms are close, then all the eigenvalues are close, most quickly. And this then implies other facts about other combinatorial properties of H. And then in hindsight, another important reason is that even though this notion of spectral approximation is stronger than the combinatorial notion, this quadratic form X transpose LX is actually a much better behaved object over Rn than over this discrete cube 0, 1 to the n. So basically, if you just look at Kutch, you're looking at a bunch of discrete objects, and it's difficult to figure out how they're all connected to each other and what the global structure is. On the other hand, if you look at this continuous quadratic form over the real numbers, there's a different kind of structure, there's more global structure, is sort of the way I think about it, and it's well behaved under a very nice set of transformations. So even though this is stronger, it's actually much easier to prove the existence of these. Okay, so here are some examples. So again, there's the example I showed you earlier. I have the complete graph on a node. If I take a random deregular graph, I showed you that all the cuts are preserved. It turns out that actually these quadratic forms are also preserved. So if I take d equal to about 1 over epsilon squared, this is not easy to prove. This is a result of Joel Friedman. Then these quadratic forms are preserved for all vectors x up to this factor. A more interesting example is a dumbbell here. So this is two copies of the complete graph drawn by a single edge. I can find a sparsifier for this by breaking it into pieces and working on the pieces. So I know that each clique is approximated by a random few regular graphs. So I take two of these. And the edge in the middle is just approximated by itself. And since the Laplacian of a graph is the sum of the Laplacians of its edges, the sum of the approximations is an approximation of the sums. So this graph approximates a dumbbell graph. And the interesting thing about this example is that the edge in the middle has to have weight 1, because there's a cut that isolates this edge. There's a cut, this cut to the middle with weight 1. So this has to have weight 1, and it has to be included. You cannot ignore this edge. And this is very different from all the other edges, which actually have weight about order n on average, because the total weight here is n squared, and here there are only n edges, so the average weight has to be order n. So the weights in this example have to vary, wildly, even though the input graph is unweighted. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about today is, how to do this for every graph. One way to do this for every graph. There are many ways at this point. And this is the theorem that I'm going to present. So every weighted graph G has a weighted subgraph H with at most 9 n log n or epsilon squared edges. So that these Laplacian approximate up to epsilon, and you can find this in nearly linear time. So you can see that view this as some sort of strengthening of the vector part of the result.
Sorry, Nikhil, do you have a question?
Yeah.
I guess this is true then, not just for graph Laplacians, for any matrix. Right?
Yeah. So I'll get to that later. Yeah. This, this is an instance of a more general result, which we'll see in a moment. This linear time computation is not a more general result at this point. Okay, so how do we prove the theorem? So the high level approach is to do random sampling. So you're given this graph G, and you're going to randomly sample some subset of its edges. So I'm going to have some probability distribution PE over the edges, and I'm going to choose each edge with this probability P sub E. And I'm going to take K samples, where K is going to be about n log n, independently, IID samples. And every time I pick up an edge E, I'm going to add it to my sparse prior H with weight 1 over the probability, 1 over k times the probability. Okay. So what this means is that my Laplacian of my graph H is going to be an average of the Laplacians of the edges that I pick up, and each edge is going to be rescaled by a weight that's inversely proportional to the probability. So if I do this, then the expected, the Laplacian of this random graph H is a random matrix. The expectation of this matrix is just the same thing as the expected Laplacian of a random edge under this distribution, which, you know, by the way I've scaled it, is just equal to the Laplacian of T. So that's why I've rescaled by the inverse probability to get the expectation of it. Because BEs are these incidence vectors. And, you know, by the law of large numbers, you know, if I take K going to infinity, if I really do this forever, then this will indeed approach the Laplacian of T. And so the question is, if you want a good algorithm, how quickly does this happen? Okay, so it certainly doesn't happen for one sample, right? If you take one edge, there's no way this LHC could be close to G. What I'm going to show is that it happens for n log n. Okay, so what's this probability distribution P? That's the only free parameter in this algorithm, the way I've described it. So the first thing to try is just uniform sampling. So just randomly take edges, you know, IID, error direction. So this works for the complete graph. So it turns out I need n log n samples, not order n, because previously I sampled matchings. But if I just sample independent edges, order n log n samples actually work. But it totally doesn't work for this dumbbell because, as I said, I really need the edge in the middle. And if I just do uniform sampling, it's going to take me basically order m, you know, number of, where m is the number of edges, samples before I can see this edge, and I need this edge. So this doesn't do very well. What I need to do is I need to find a distribution which is biased towards picking this edge in the middle. I'm going to get this to work. So it turned out there's a very nice distribution which works, and it's very simple to describe, and it's based on this important concept called effective resistance, which is also probably generally an important concept for this. So what's the effective resistance? So it's a physical and electrical concept. So I have a graph G. The effective resistance of an edge in the graph is the energy dissipation when I inject and remove a unit current across the endpoints of this edge. So what does that look like? So here's a graph, and I pick some edge. I want to look at its effective resistance. I put 1 amp across it. And then I get an electrical flow. The electrical flow is the flow which minimizes energy. In this case, it's not very interesting because there's only 1 path from between the endpoints of this edge, so it just sends this 1 amp back. And now I can compute the energy of this. It's just 1 squared, so it's whatever the sum of the potential resistance squared, so it's just 1. So the effective resistance of this edge is 1. But if I look at this edge instead, right, so if I put this unit current across this edge, something more interesting happens. Now there are 2 paths that electricity can travel through. And because I want to minimize the sum of squares, I want to minimize the energy, it's beneficial to send some amount of current on the longer path. So what ends up happening is that it sends 2/3 of its current on the path of length 1 and 1/3 on the path of length 2. And now if I look at the sum of squares, it's 2/3. The effective resistance is lower. And the basic idea is if you have nodes that are connected by many alternate paths where electricity can flow, to minimize the energy, it'll use some of those paths, and this will give you a lower energy dissipation which will give you lower effective resistance. And you want to think of these edges that have low resistance as being electrically sort of redundant. So this edge here with the high resistance, this is absolutely crucial. You cannot touch this edge. If you delete this edge, you disconnect the network. This, there are many alternate ways to go, so it's sort of redundant. You can delete this edge. So this is the sort of manipulation. If you have few alternate paths, then you have high resistance, and it's very important from an electrical point of view. And if you have many paths, on the other hand, you have lower resistance, and this is sort of redundant from an electrical point of view. So the basic idea is I'm going to use this as a measure of how important an edge is, and I'm just going to use this as a probability distribution. So I'm going to sample edges with probability proportional to the effective resistance. And so this is literally the algorithm, sample this number of edges independently according to effective resistances. Okay. So are there any questions about the statement of the algorithm, the statement of the theorem?
How do you decide which edges to try putting current across?
Okay. So this is the definition of effective resistance. So to compute the resistance of an edge E, I put a unit current, mm-hmm. always a unit current. And I'm going to do this for all edges in the graph. So for every edge, I'm going to get a number.
Okay.
The number is going to be between 0 and 1 because, you know, I put 1 amp of current, so the energy is at most 1. And I'm going to do it for every edge. Okay. Okay. So I'll show you a proof of this in three steps. Okay. So the first step is to reduce this to a straight linear algebra problem, which has nothing really to do with graphs. We just view this as a special case of a problem of matrices, and solve this problem using some random matrix theory results, and then finally show how to do it quickly. So I promised that I could do this in nearly linear time. I need to show you how to compute these effective resistances very quickly. Okay, so let's do the first part. So this is what I want to do, right? I'm given and this is based on joint work with Van Skilden. So I'm given a graph G, and I want to find a sparse graph H so that these Laplacians are close like this. And recall that a Laplacian is the sum of outer products. Okay, so let's assume the input graph is unweighted. It contains all the ideas. Let's assume it's unweighted. The Laplacian is just a sum over these outer products, which I'm going to call B sub E. For an edge E, I'm going to have an incidence vector B sub E, which is just delta I minus delta J for the endpoint. And what I'm interested in finding is the weighted subgraph of this graph. So the Laplacian of H is also a sum of outer products. And the key point is that if H is a weighted subgraph of G, so that means that this edge set of H is a subset of the edge set of G, but the weights are allowed to be different, then it's actually a weighted sum of the same outer products. Okay, so if these are the edges in G, the edges in H are a subset of the edges in G, so it's a re-weighted sum of the same outer products. So this graph H is really described by these weights S sub E for every edge in the original graph G, and this is the weight of that edge in G, in H. And what I expect is that most of these weights are going to be zero, because I want H to be sparse. So most of these weights are going to be zero, the rest of them are going to be blown up or something like that. And I'm looking for these weights. So this is what I want to do. Given G, find sparse H with this property. It's equivalent to saying, given the sum of outer products of incidence vectors, find some non-negative weights. So it's important the weights are non-negative, that are sparse, so mostly zero, with this property. Okay. So at this point, I want to tell you about a nice way of thinking about these sums of outer products and their quadratic forms. So basically, the way you should think about it is as an ellipsoid. So suppose I have a graph G and it's a sum of outer products. I have some vectors BE, they live in RN, so they look like this. And the quadratic form is a quadratic polynomial, right? So if I plot its level sets, if I look at the sets X transpose LX is at most less than or equal to 1, I get an ellipsoid. Okay, I mean the equation for an ellipsoid is it's some homogeneous quadratic polynomial at most one. So the level sets of these vectors look like ellipsoids. So I want to think of the shape of these vectors as being, you know, this ellipsoid. And now it turns out that if I look at my graph H, which is, remember, a weighted subgraph of G, what that means is I choose some of the vectors and I change their weights. So I make them orange. Whatever they're just in the way, make them longer or shorter. And this has a different quadratic form, and it has a different ellipsoid, which is going to be red here.
Okay.
And now the nice thing that happens is that this notion of approximation of quadratic forms, where I want the for every test vector x, I want them to be within a factor of kappa. This is literally just a statement about containment of these ellipsoids. So all it's saying is that the ellipsoid for g is contained in the ellipsoid for h, which is contained in kappa times the ellipsoid for g. It's a multiplicative approximation of this quadratic form. Okay, and now there's something very important and very basic, but really important, and basically the only thing that happens in the proof that happens here, which is this notion of containment of ellipsoids, this notion of multiplicative approximation matrices, is invariant under rescaling everything by some other matrix. Okay, so what it means is I want LG less than LH less than kappa times LG. If I multiply everything by some invertible matrix M on both sides, it's still true. So this statement is invariant under multiplication by some invertible matrix. And so, you know, I can apply any affine transformation, you know, that I can rescale this however I want, and it's sort of the same thing. And now it turns out there's a very nice choice of m. So I'm going to take m to be the square root of the inverse of LG. Okay, so I'm going to take m to be the square root of the inverse of LG. If I do this, it turns out the effect that it has is it rescales this outer ellipsoid.
M has to be symmetric?
Yes. M is symmetric.
Yeah. I'm sorry, yeah. Okay, so, yes. So, right. So if I choose m to be the square root of the inverse of LT, then this ellipsoid for G just becomes the sphere. All right. And so the statement that I wanted to prove boils down to this. I want to find an h so that LG to the minus half, LH, LG to the minus half, lies between identity and kappa times the identity. And this is a very nice statement because it's just a statement about, well, it's a statement about eigenvalues of the matrix lying between 1 and kappa.
Yeah.
Excuse me?
To be clear, so this is only on the orthogonal subspace.
Yeah. So throughout the talk, I'm ignoring all one vector. So the identity is also orthogonal to the one vector. And you know, this object comes up a lot in this area, and it doesn't really have a name, but you know, you can think of it as dividing H by D, or you can think of it as some sort of relative Laplacian of the graphs H and D. Okay. And this is really the thing that you can do here with this spectral setup that you could not do in the combinatorial setup. There's no, I mean, this is very simple, but if you're just looking at cuts, it's not easy to find a transfer. There's no analog of this, basically. Okay, so I want to find this H. You know, what is this H? It's a weighted sum of these outer products, B, E, B, E transpose. So I want to find these weights so that this weighted sum of outer products has eigenvalues between 1 and kappa. And I'm going to call these vectors, these rescaled incidence vectors, V sub E. So for each incidence vector V sub E, I have a rescaled vector, LG to the minus half V sub E. And now our problem is reduced to this. Given these V sub E's, find these weights S sub E, find some rescaling of them so that this thing approximates the sphere. And what do I know about the V sub E's? Well, I know that the sum of their outer products is equal to the identity. So what I know about them is if I set all the weights equal to 1, I get the sphere, right? So therefore, the only thing I know about these vectors is that they add up to the identity. So this is also called a tight frame. You may have heard of this. It's also called the Jones decomposition. And you can think of it as some sort of generalization of an orthonormal basis. Okay. So this is the problem I want to solve. Given these vectors that add up to the identity, find these weights. And the picture is something like this. So now I'm going to forget that these vectors came from a graph. It sounds like a very heavy-handed thing to do. I'm just going to forget that they're just going to solve this problem for arbitrary vectors. Given m vectors and Rn that look like this, and what I know is that the variance is the same in every direction. And I want to find these weights.
What would you say? The variance is the same?
The second moment is the same in every direction. I'm sorry. The second moment. So I'm I don't know why I wrote variance here, so I'm just, this is the quadratic form is equal to one in every direction.
Okay.
But yeah, if you're used to thinking about statistics, it's a covariance matrix, so it's equal to the identity.
Do you gain in generality by doing that? Like, when you look over all possible graphs, do you get all possible vectors, or, you know, you just get some?
Do you get all possible vectors? No, you don't. So that's an interesting question that, is this, you know, what do the vectors that come from graphs look like? So they actually have some special properties, and you cannot get all sets of vectors from graphs. So if you take random vectors, it's very different from what you get from graphs. There are a lot of degeneracy there. So yeah, I mean, that's another good question, because so far, you know, most uses of this methodology, you just say that, oh, there's some vectors, and you forget everything about them. And it would be useful to try to use the thinking.
So can I also ask a question? Yeah. So these VEs, in previous slides, you were calling them rescaled incident vectors.
Yeah.
And there you mean that they're actually just rescaled versions of VE, or?
Yeah. So then, I mean, all I did exactly one thing so far, which is apply this transformation LD to the device.
So it's not a rotation, it's just always just a rescale.
It's a positive semi-definite matrix. So it maps to it, sorry. okay, so this is the problem I want to solve. And you know, why am I making such a big deal out of this? Like, I'm not just doing this for fun. So there's a reason why you would want to do this. It actually tells you something. So let's see what this actually does. So you start with a complete graph, and let's write down its incidence vectors, and let's write down its Laplacian. Well, it turns out that the incidence vectors of the complete graph are very symmetric, and you already get something that's equal to this here. So when you do this rescaling, it doesn't change anything. The VEs are actually just going to be equal to the VEs for the complete. But when you do this for the dumbbell, something really interesting happens. So if you write down the vectors for the incidence vectors for the dumbbell, and you plot this ellipsoid, you plot the quadratic form, you get something that's really squashed. So you get something that's very flat in one direction. And this one direction, basically there's these two bunches of edges corresponding to these two cliques. And then there's one direction orthogonal to everything else with just one incidence vector. And that's his edge in the middle. And when you rescale this now to be the identity, it stretches this direction so that it has the same size as the other direction. And then the norm of this one vector gets blown up a lot. So when you do this rescaling, it actually tells you, it actually finds these edges which are crucial. I mean, if you just look at it here, you might sort of miss this edge, right? Because it's very small. But because I'm interested in multiplicative approximation, I care about small things just as much as I care about big things. And you know, that's why this rescaling makes sense, basically. And this reveals some of these crucial vectors. If you do this, the norm of this vector gets blown up to 1, whereas the norms of these vectors are actually going to be something really small, like 1 over n. So it tells you that this is the real important thing. And you know, coming back to what I said earlier about resistances, it turns out there's a nice connection here. So for a graph G, the vectors are these rescaled incidence vectors. And let me compute the lengths of the vectors. So the squared lengths of the vectors are the squares of squared norms of these vectors, which is just a quadratic form in the inverse of the Laplacian. It's the incidence vector transpose inverse of the Laplacian. And what is this quantity? Well, this quantity turns out to be something we already know. So the electrical flow minimizes energy dissipation. So remember I told you that to compute the electrical flow, you inject some currents and find the flow minimizing energy. So you can write this as a convex program. If you write down the optimality conditions for this, it tells you that the minimum value of the energy is equal to this, B transpose L inverse B. So this quantity that shows up here is actually literally the effective resistance. Right? So this is beginning to confirm sort of what we said earlier, that when you do this rescaling, these sizes that you see are just the effective resistances. And this rescaling is something that also has been done in the numerical linear algebra literature, where these norms are called leverage scores. There's a lot of work. There's work of Friesgen and Lampala and Rudelson and Rashinen, where again, you have some matrix and you want to find out which columns are important. And what you do is you apply some transformation and you get these leverage scores, which tell you which columns are important. Okay, so these are just the effective resistances. So this sort of confirms what we said earlier. I want the graph to be electrically equivalent. The edges, I thought that the edges with higher resistance are more important. Well, it turns out if I do this thing, it shows up. Like, it's almost like a principal derivation by this sort of, you know, algebraic reasoning that this is the way. Okay, so this is the problem I want to solve. And how do I solve this problem? I'm going to solve this problem using random matrix theory. So my input is m vectors in Rn, and my output is supposed to be a sparse set of weights, Si. So, you know, I'm given these vectors whose outer product is out of Pn. Again, I'm going to do random sampling. So I'm going to define a random matrix that chooses one of these outer products according to some distribution Pi, some probability which I haven't determined yet. And again, it's going to be rescaled by 1 over the probability in order to preserve the expectation. Then the expectation of this matrix is the identity, the way I've set it up. And again, I want to take a bunch of samples so that the empirical mean of these samples is close to the expectation, which is the identity. And the question is, how many samples do I need? Okay, so this matrix that I'm interested in is a sum of independent random matrices, independent IID matrices. And there are some very well-developed tools in random matrix theory for analyzing things like this. So recall that, you know, in just in the scalar world, there's this Chernoff bound, which says that if you have IID random variables that are positive, that are non-negative, and bounded by some number m, and let's rescale them so that their expectation is equal to 1, then the probability that this empirical mean, you know, is bigger, is far away from 1, decays exponentially in the square of this deviation, and this bound gets worse as the bound on the random variables gets worse. So they're unbounded, you can prove something like this. But if you have some absolute bound on your random variables, then you have this Chernoff bound, which I guess everybody knows. And, you know, what this expression says is, in particular, that if you take 4m over epsilon squared samples from such a distribution, then you get close to the expectation with constant probability, where m is your bound on the size of your random variables. Okay. So it turns out there's a very satisfactory generalization of this to matrices, which is sometimes called the matrix Chernoff bound. And this, what I'm about to show you is originally proved by Rudelson, but now has been refined by Alsgood, Winter, and Kropp, and others. And the statement is syntactically very similar to what I told you about scalars. So if I have x1 through xk IID random matrices, not vectors now, d by d random matrices, and I know that they're positive semi-definite and at most m times the identity. So the eigenvalues are at most m. And the expectation is equal to the identity, let's say. Let's just rescale them so the expectation is equal to the identity. Then the probability of the norm of this empirical sum minus the identity is bigger than epsilon. So the probability of the eigenvalues of this random matrix are not between 1 plus minus epsilon is at most 2 times the dimension. So the only difference here is this dimension factor, which is important. So previously it's just some exponential. Here you get the dimension times the same exponential.
Rudelson's bound was only for rank 1?
Yeah, Rudelson's bound is only for rank 1, but this is for any rank. Okay, so this is, and what this implies is if you want this number to be, you know, much less than 1, it turns out if you take 4m log d over epsilon squared samples, that's enough to get your empirical mean close to the expectation. Constant probability. So the only difference here is this log d. And again, the number of samples really depends on m, how big are your random matrices. So let's look at the situation we have here. We have a random matrix, which is equal to one of these outer products, scaled by the probability. And I want this m to be small. So I want to choose these probabilities so that each of these matrices is small. Okay, so what is the norm of this matrix? Well, okay, it's just the norm of VIVI transpose divided by VI. And I want the maximum of these things, which is m, to be small. Okay, well, the norm of this rank 1 outer product is just the squared norm of the vector Vi, right? So I want to choose the probabilities in a way that these numbers, the square norms of the VIs divided by the probabilities, are small. And I want this for all my vectors. So to make this tight for all vectors, the right thing to do, the optimal thing to do actually, is to set each probability proportional to the square norm. So for the vector I, I'm just going to set the probability to be equal to norm VI squared divided by m, or m, well, it's to be determined. And these are the PIs I'm going to use. And now the question is, what is m when I do this? Well, what do I know? I know that the probabilities add up to 1. Right? So the sum of the probabilities is 1. So the sum of these norm VI squares over m is equal to 1. OK, but what is this? The norm of VI squared is just the trace of the number product VI VI transpose. Right? Trace is linear. I can take it out. This is just the trace of the sum of the outer products divided by n. But I know what this is. I know what the sum of the outer products is. It's the identity in n dimensions. So this is just equal to n over m. So you have m vectors in Rn. These probabilities are just going to be the squared norms divided by m, where m is going to be equal to n, just the ambient dimension. So what that means is you take 4 n log n over epsilon squared samples, that's enough. Okay. So that's it. You just apply the matrix Chernoff bound. It tells you to take basically order n log n over epsilon squared vectors and sample with probabilities proportional to the squared norms. And rescale in this sort of clear way, then you get an approximation of the identity. And again, for the vectors that I'm interested in, rescaled incidence vectors, these are literally effective resistances. And again, this is not really about the identity. This is a statement about any matrix, any sum of outer products. Because as I said, this notion of approximation is invariant under affine rescaling. So if this thing is not the identity, I can just apply v to the minus half and make it change. Okay. So that gives me this theorem, except for this linear time part, right? So I haven't told you how to compute these probabilities. I need to sample according to these effective resistances, but I need to compute them really quickly if I'm going to do this. So how do I do that? So this is the third part in which I'm going to show you how to compute these things quickly, and this really uses the fact that it's a graph. It uses the fact that the incident vector is called a graph. Okay. So how do you do this? So I'm going to derive an alternate expression for the effective resistance. Okay. So recall that the Laplacian of a graph is the sum of outer products of incidence vectors, which I can write as B transpose B, where B is an M by N matrix whose rows are the incidence vectors. So that's just how matrix multiplication works. If I put these vectors in the rows, I get L is equal to B transpose B. So now recall that my sampling probabilities were the squared norms of my rescaled incidence vectors, which are just these quadratic forms in the inverse of the Laplacian, LG inverse, but LG is equal to B transpose B. So I can replace LG inverse by LG inverse B transpose B LG inverse. I can do that, right? And now I get that this squared norm is equal to B L inverse times this incidence vector BE, which is just some delta I minus delta B. Okay, why have I done this? I've done this to reveal that these squared norms of these that I'm interested in are just squared distances between certain columns, between pairs of columns, of some matrix, which is BL inverse, where B is this incidence matrix, sine incidence matrix. Okay? So that means that the effective distance between two points I and J is just the distance between the ith and jth columns of this fixed matrix, BL inverse. So I can compute this matrix on that. So all I really care about is distances between columns of this matrix are n columns, and they live in Rm, right? For every vertex, there's a column. And to get the resistance between I and j, I just compute the distance, squared distance between the ith and jth columns. So that's all I care about. So this brings me to this other very useful tool, which is called the Johnson-Lewis-Strauss lemma, which you may already have seen. And it's amazing results. So what it says is if you have n points in d dimensions, and you only care about their Euclidean distances between them, then this is preserved by a random projection onto log n over epsilon squared directions. Okay. So I have these points x1 over xn. I choose a k by n random projection onto a uniformly random k-dimensional subspace. And then I get these vectors qxi, which are now points in Rk, where k is much less than n. then the norms in this projective space are very close to the norms in the original space. And this dimension only depends on the number of points, and it depends logarithmically. So this is also not very difficult to prove. It's essentially just a consequence of concentration of measure or Gaussian space. And if you don't like this concept of a random k-dimensional projection, you can just take a random Bernoulli matrix. Also works. Take a random k by n plus minus 1 matrix. Okay, so once you have this, this is very good for us because we have these n vectors in Rm, and m is big, and we care about the distances between them. But now, Johnson-Lindstrauss lemma tells us that I can project them into the log n dimensional space and preserve the distances up to, say, a factor of 1 plus minus half. So initially, I was interested in these vectors BL inverse, columns of BL inverse. Now I'm interested in the columns of QBL inverse, where Q is my random projection onto log n dimension. So the picture looks like this. BL inverse was some tall matrix, m by m matrix. I only cared about the distances between its columns. I applied this log n by m fat matrix, and I got this tiny matrix Z, which is log n by m. It's a really tiny object. Okay. And now my, you know, what I'm going to do is show you how to compute this matrix Z, which is, you should think of it as a projection of this embedding in nearly linear time. And since this preserves the square distances, the distances in the columns of Z squared are very close to the effective distances. So this is also pretty cool. So what is Z, right? It's Q, which is a random projection, times BL inverse, where B is the incidence matrix, L is the inverse of L plus. So Z equals QBL inverse, right? What that means is that Z times L equals QB. It's multiplied by L on both sides. And what that means is that the ith row of Z, so Z has log n rows, the ith row of Z times L is equal to the ith row of QB. That's just sort of an obvious fact. And the point is, this is a system of linear equations in Laplacian. I'm interested in finding Zi so that Lzi equals something that I know. And this QB is something I can compute quickly, because this B is a sparse matrix and Q is a small random matrix. So I can compute each row of Z individually by solving a system of Laplacian linear equations. And this is something which, at this point, can be done faster than sorting, but could be done quite fast even a while ago. And you know, the picture here is that, I mean, it's pretty cool what's going on. It's able to learn all the pairwise resistances by computing a few random electrical flows, because that's what these are after all, right? They're electrical flows with random potentials.
Nikhil, the original application for specification.
Yeah, I'm about to talk about that. Yeah. So there's a circularity. And then of course this only gets you these guys within a constant factor. But it turns out that if you get within, say, a factor of 2, it only changes your m and your turn off bound by a factor of 2, and you blow up your samples by a factor of 2, and everything works. So this is the whole algorithm. You're given the graph. You want to find the subgraph. What you do is you compute the, you take the random projection matrix. You compute this approximate resistance embedding, which is, you may want to call it that. And then you do this by solving Laplacian equations. And now the squared distances between these columns give you the resistances. You sample the edges according to these approximate resistances. And you do this n log n times, and you get the classifier. And this has been approved by several people, but in particular, Kudis, Levin, and Feng I've done a much nicer error analysis than, well, I mean, I didn't talk about the error analysis, but I think it's down to m log squared n. Okay, but there's a major issue here, as Luca pointed out, which is my original goal was to solve Lx equals b. I told you that to do that, computing a sparsifier was a useful thing. But then I told you that the way to compute a sparsifier is to solve log n Lx equals b, which this is bad, right? So the original Spielman Tank paper actually had a completely different algorithm for sparsification, which got n log to the eighth n edges, which avoided the circularity entirely. So you can do that. But now there's this extremely elegant way to actually avoid this and to somehow bootstrap this process due to Kudis, Miller, and Peng, which I believe John will talk about in detail in his talks. So there's a way to use this sampling idea sort of slowly and actually do these things together. Okay, so I want to conclude just by, I told you about graph sparsification, but really maybe what I want you to take away from this is that, these are a couple of interesting ways of looking at a graph that mean, you may not originally be familiar with. So one is, you know, as an electrical network, this gives you a different kind of intuition from looking at it combinatorially. The other is a bunch of vectors, and looking at these ellipsoids, and this suggests, you know, these interesting transformations like scaling, which aren't obvious at the outset. And the connection between these two pictures is that, well, the norms of the squared norms of the vectors in this picture are the resistances in this picture. And we use these two tools from random matrix theory to analyze, to analyze this process and show that we can do it quickly. And you know, the basic, I mean, really only one thing happened in this entire hour that I talked to you, which is I rescaled everything by the inverse of the square root of that. And this is something which is not obvious if you just use combinatorics. And once you once you write everything in linear algebra, you can use these tools of random matrix theory. So there are a bunch of there are many improvements to this. So as I mentioned, Kudus-Levin and Feng have a much nicer analysis to get the running time down. There's a one-pass streaming algorithm due to Kellner and Levin. So if you actually want to do this on some huge amount of data, you can store memory. There's a parallel algorithm due to Kudus, and very recently there's this very impressive algorithm by Kapralov, Lee, Musko, and Flitford, which is a one-pass dynamic streaming algorithm, which means you can delete videos as well. And okay, what I'm going to talk about in the afternoon is a slower algorithm. So it takes n to the fifth or something time, but it gets rid of the log n, for as far as with n over epsilon squared edges. And it's based on this picture of sort of blowing up a baboon. So instead of doing random sampling, you add these edges one by one and track how these look so they move around. And yeah, I'm going to have open questions at the end of each talk. So one is, can you approximate resistances faster? I mean, a lot of people who actually tried to use this have wanted to be able to do this without solving linear equations at all. And it would be nice to have some, well, actually some combinatorial algorithm for doing this. And in general, more physical processes on graphs. Are there other interesting things we can look at? That's it.
Questions. So in the first question, approximation could even be polylogon approximation.
The first question? Oh yeah, yeah. So in the first question, yeah, so the sampling process, whatever slop you have in the resistance, it just goes into the M. So yeah, you could even get polylogon approximation, and you know, there are some ways of doing things recursively where you might even be able to get by the less than that.
Yeah. What if you're not interested in all the vertices of the graph, but only a few terminals, and you want to preserve some sort of Dirichlet spectral structure?
Dirichlet spectral structure.
Like
so
in some sense, I just want to preserve the. For any fixing of x, to minimize the energy.
Right. And the support of x is restricted.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, there's a way of collapsing the whole electrical network into a network with k nodes, which is equivalent by basically taking a Schur complement. But I don't know if that's what you want to do. it's a good question. So there's a result by I don't know. Beyond that, I don't actually know.
So is that quantum interpretation of what you're doing in terms of theorems?
In terms of what?
In terms of a generalized measurement of a quantum system that you can take any generalized measurement and make it approximated by something that doesn't have many outcomes.
I see. So you're interpreting the quadratic form as outcome of that.
Right, and yeah. And the summing to identity, that's a theorem.
Uh-huh. I see. Yeah, I guess it is saying that. I mean, they're all rank one though, so it's very specific. I think that's a major. So the matrices are more general. There are results like this for more general matrices, but for example, Sato, Silva, and Harvey. So it's a good question if you can do this for general measurement. What